Before proceeding to session one of our agenda, I would like to mention a few of our sponsors. We've mentioned them already, but I don't think we can thank them enough for the substantial support that they've provided to this event. So just a few of them I'll mention right now. We have Bayer Crop Sciences, Avera Health, Brock Grain Systems, and CHS. If there are folks from those companies and organizations, would you mind just standing or raising your hand so we can give you a big thank you? We are quite privileged to have the next panel of speakers come and join us for our program. I will introduce them and then we'll have presentations from them. We'll have time for questions that I'll moderate at the end of both of their presentations, so be thinking of things that you'd like to ask. We definitely want this to be an interactive day, so be sure to jot down those questions as you think of them. First, we have Alex Bjork. Alex serves as the manager of agriculture supply chains for the World Wildlife Fund and has worked since 2009 to develop sustainable supply chains. Bjork has a history degree from Concordia College and an international MBA and master's in international affairs from the University of Denver. Mr. Brian Klippenstein is also with us today. Brian serves as the executive director for Protect the Harvest. Klippenstein grew up on a beef cattle farm in Missouri, or Missouri, as I'm told it's pronounced by the locals. He has served in various public service roles for the past 26 years, including 5 years serving as chief of staff for U.S. Senator Kit Bond. Brian and his wife, Jackie, have 2 kids and reside on a small livestock farm near Platte City, Missouri. Brian is a competitive offshore sailboat racer and has completed over 50 marathons, all fueled by a high-protein diet containing nutrient-dense, genetically improved, corn-fed red meat. These gentlemen will be addressing national and global perspectives on current issues like the utilization of biotechnology to create genetically modified crops and organisms, animal husbandry practices, sustainability, and opportunities for industry participation in these critical societal discussions. Please help me in welcoming our panelists.
Thank you, everyone. It's wonderful to be here in Deadwood. I've always loved this part of the world. I grew up in North Dakota and in Fargo, and then moved in my high school days to Colorado. So I've made the drive across the state many times, and I always love coming back. So I'm very glad to be here and privileged to represent the World Wildlife Fund and speak to you today about some of the global issues in food and agriculture and sustainability that we're seeing and how we might collectively navigate some of these challenges going forward. Some of you might not be as familiar with WWF, the World Wildlife Fund, so I wanted to give a quick background. We are a global conservation organization. We work in 100 countries around the world. And we have are supported by over 1 million members in the United States and 5 million members globally. We do have a global reach. We are a science-based organization, and we try to find pragmatic solutions, but local to global levels, and solutions that meet the needs of both humans and nature. So one of those challenges is how do we feed a growing population while still conserving places around the world that we care about. Most of the staff at WWF in the U.S. is based in D.C., as am I, but we do have staff in this part of the world, in Rapid City, and an office in Bozeman, Montana, and staff in Denver. So some of you may be asking yourself, why is WWF, a conservation organization, here talking about agriculture? We don't produce food, we don't grow livestock, we don't grow crops, and we don't own land. Yet the impacts of agriculture and food production and demand for commodities globally are impacting the places that we care about, whether that be the Amazon, places in Indonesia, or right here outside these doors, the northern Great Plains of the U.S. and Canada. And so when we take a look at these places and some of the issues and impacts happening in those places, we found that there's about 15 commodities globally that are having impacts. And if we can work together with industries, with businesses, to find ways to produce more with less, we can reduce the impacts on those areas. And so how do we drive change? We found that by working with the private sector, working with industry, working with producers, we can address the rate of change that's happening, which is unprecedented in society today. And business and private sector represents the greatest opportunity to drive change through market forces. So looking at global, at food and agriculture globally, and especially from the conservation perspective, you obviously see the large global impacts, whether that be water, freshwater use, greenhouse gas emissions, land use, energy use, and even food waste. Unfortunately, about a third of food that's produced is wasted. Yet, we all rely on food and agriculture. We're all connected to it. It's an important source of livelihoods around the world, and it's central to many cultures around the world, including here in the United States. So to make progress on these issues, agriculture and food systems are not the enemy. It should not be an issue of us versus them when we're talking about conservation and food. We're all directly connected to agriculture, so we have to collaborate and find solutions to some of these challenges going forward. I think many of you probably are aware of some of the global trends that are facing us by the year 2050 with population growth, increasing consumption, and rising incomes. I framed the title of this talk about the 2050 question because if we continue to frame these issues in terms of the year 2050, I believe it's just sort of kicking the can forward. The real issue isn't what happens in 2050. It's what's happening right now, and it's going to play out over the next few decades. So can we manage the rate of change that we're seeing? That again, is unprecedented. And some studies have said that in the next 30 to 40 years, we have to produce enough food, or as much food as we've produced in the last 8,000 years. So when we think about the ask of agriculture, it's increasingly not so much as feeding the world, but it's also producing fuel and fiber, renewable materials. And so can we adapt to these changes fast enough and continue to feed the world and still have places in nature that we care about? So if you look more closely at population growth, and there's some startling realities here, and the majority of population growth going forward is where food is not. And so when you look at this and you have issues such as food price spikes, lack of food availability, and food insecurity, the very startling social, economic, and political realities going forward. Another trend that we're following is volatility in the marketplace. And so this is the FAO Food Price Index over the last 20 years or so. And we see in the last 6 or 7, 8 years, food prices are becoming increasingly volatile. This is due in part to increasing demand, but also drivers such as of weather and drought. So how we manage through this period of uncertainty is going to be important. So I've mentioned, how do we produce more with less? When we look at conservation and when we look at land use and protecting habitats, we look at it from a land use perspective. And so this simple sort of back of the envelope calculation, when we look at the land mass that's available in the world, you take out what's currently in production, which is about a third of it, and you set aside mountains and deserts and urban areas. And if we want to protect forests, which contain most of the biodiversity on Earth, and if we want to continue to protect our national parks and other places that we like to visit, we don't have much room to move. So when you place on top of this in rising consumption, the biofuels, renewable materials, and impacts and potential crop migration due to climate change, there isn't a lot of room to move. And so certainly increased efficiency and use of technology are fantastic tools to address some of the issues, but efficiency can only get you so far when you're running up against some very real natural resource constraints. And one of those issues that we're concerned about is deforestation. Land conversion and habitat loss is projected to increase, and part of this is due to increasing demand and expanding agriculture frontier. But a big part of deforestation globally is about poor governance and lack of enforcement of existing laws. So this is a picture of Teso Nila National Park in Indonesia, and it's ground zero of deforestation driven primarily by palm production, palm oil production. And 50% of this national park, which is in Riau, Indonesia, has been completely overrun by palm oil. It's completely turfed. It's home to orangutans, tigers, elephants, but also many indigenous populations that rely on forests for their livelihoods. So the issue here isn't palm oil. It's not agriculture. In fact, palm oil is a great crop, very profitable, it's productive, and it's an excellent source of income, especially for smallholders. The problem is how it's being developed. Corruption and poor governance are major systemic issues in the country, and it's these systemic issues that are driving deforestation globally. But there is a way forward, and trying to be pragmatic, and when you look at these global issues, how can we kind of tease them apart and find leverage and areas and ways that we can address them? So when we look at global deforestation, if you break it down, two countries and four sectors are half of the problem. So within Brazil and Indonesia, you have half of global deforestation and the drivers of palm oil, pulp, paper, soy, and beef. So if we can get our arms around that and find solutions by working together with business and producers and governments, we can make significant progress, and we are seeing progress, and it's led by the private sector and their commitments to address deforestation in their supply chains going forward. But closer to home, where deforestation in the United States is not as pressing of an issue, we have another issue, and that's grassland conversion. And this often gets overlooked. Conversion in the U.S. has accelerated in recent years, largely due to commodity prices. And studies have shown that grassland conversion in the U.S. is equal in rates to that of deforestation in Brazil and Indonesia. And some people don't realize the global significance of grasslands. They're very important ecosystems for wildlife, storing carbon, and also providing freshwater quality. But many of these grasslands also provide economic livelihoods within the ranching sector, and I'll talk about that in a moment. But temperate grasslands across the world are one of the least protected biomes on the planet. And historically, if you look back 200 years, grasslands were huge. The orange portions of this map represent the historic grasslands of the world 200 years ago, and the green represents what we have left today. And in the northern Great Plains, we have about 180 million acres of grasslands that stretch over five states. And two Canadian provinces, and it's this area that WWF is very interested in conserving. And I'll come back to this grassland issue in a moment and speak about some of the activities and partners that we're working with to help protect this important area. I think everyone in this room knows how critical water is. And you can't produce food without it. All you have to do is look at the newspaper every day and read about issues in California and a few years ago, issues in Texas, and even in Brazil today, they're experiencing the worst drought in 80 years. But I like to show this graphic because I think it helps drive the point home about how valuable water is on the planet. And we often look, maybe if we see the planet like this, we see it as very blue. There's a lot of water available in oceans, rivers, and lakes. But this graphic from the Woods Hole Institute shows if you take all the water in the world, and which is the large sphere there over the United States, that's all the water in the world in relative in size and mass to the land mass of the entire Earth. The smaller sphere, which is about over Ohio, that's all the fresh water in the world, groundwater, lakes, ice, rivers, streams. And then there's a tiny dot that's over at Atlanta, which many of you might not even be able to see. But this is all the water in lakes and rivers. And this is also, lakes and rivers are the source of the majority of irrigation water that we use to produce food. So I think this helps us think differently about water. I mean, in reality, the world is really just covered by a thin veneer. And going forward with increasing demand, water is going to become increasingly scarce and a valuable resource going forward. So continuing on that water theme, this is a climate risk drought map looking at the decade of the 2030s. At WWF, we think that actually through the water lens and the issue of water scarcity is probably the lens where we'll see the climate change impacts happening the most, and we already see this happening. And when we look at a map like this, we can't help but ask ourselves, looking at the areas of the world that will be most affected, are today's breadbaskets going to be tomorrow's? You know, how can we make agriculture more resilient to climate change, and how can we find some proactive solutions so that we can continue to feed the world? So given all these issues, expectations are changing. Expectations for business, for industry, and for agriculture. Companies are increasingly being held accountable for the impacts in their supply chains, and they're being expected to provide transparency and accountability for where their food comes from and how it was produced. Part of this is risk management, but it's also evolving to becoming more about sustainability being a business imperative. NGOs like ourselves and others are seen more as partners than we were maybe 5 or 10 years ago, and helping companies and industries figuring out what to do and how to address these challenges is an area we've been focused on. So I think the key message that we've tried to stress is that sustainability can't be achieved alone. We can't do it alone. Business can't do it alone. And the agriculture sector can't do it alone. The issues are very complex. But if we work together and collaborate and find proactive solutions based around shared interests and values and build trust, then we can solve some of these issues. So continuing on, we also look at supply chains. So thinking is changing, so are supply chains. Most commodity supply chains by nature are transactional, based on price and quality and quantity. But going forward, as sustainability becomes more and more of a business imperative, we need supply chains that are more about partnerships and value creation and information exchange. And in fact, how can sustainability claims be credibly shared across supply chains so that the value that's created isn't just for the brands and companies and traders, but also for farmers and producers? You know, what's the value proposition of sustainability for the farmer? And we have to be asking these questions. And we have to be innovating within the supply chain. And so it's important that we have discussions and involve all stakeholders in the process and find out what the incentives are. And what we're finding is it's not always about premiums, because in many cases companies aren't going to pay more for sustainability. It's becoming an expectation of doing business. So how do you find other incentives, whether these are long-term contracts, access to markets, reduced credit costs, et cetera. There's no simple solution, but it's important that we be considering about the incentives for all parts of the supply chain. And so one way that WWF has been working is through multi-stakeholder initiatives. I mentioned at the beginning that we're focused on about 15 commodities globally that impact places of conservation importance. And these are some of the initiatives that we've been involved with, some of which are just beginning in very early stages, and some that are more mature. But the idea behind these is if we get all the right stakeholders at the table, you can define what sustainability means for the industry. I think sustainability means many things to many people, but if you can get enough stakeholders in the room that have shared interests and you're focusing on the key things that matter most and the problems you're trying to solve, you can make progress. And so these initiatives have helped define sustainability for various industries and helped find solutions for how you can verify and track performance and create value across the supply chain. And I'll talk a bit more about the Keystone Field to Market Alliance for U.S. Agriculture in a moment. So getting back to America's grasslands, this is the green on this map represents the historical grasslands of the U.S. And the area in black is the area that WWF is very interested in preserving and keeping intact. So looking closer, this is our best estimate of what remains today is the area in green. Some oil and gas development has fragmented some of this landscape, especially in North Dakota and parts of Wyoming. And conversion to cropland has happened along the eastern edge, but the large majority remains intact. And so if we're going to continue to preserve the grass of this part of the world, we need to prioritize the areas of focus and identify partners. So of the about 260 counties that are in this region, we identified about 45, and those are the areas in blue, that are very important to finding partners and working with to protect the grasslands of this part of the world. And the areas in sort of the light green are those buffer counties where there is some conversion to cropland, but you still have large areas remaining intact. So how do we do this? Well, we have to find partners. And when we look at partners, we have to look at the ownership of this region. And a large portion of the ownership of this region is owned by private landowners, so we're over 80%, and that represents all that light green area. The purple are federal lands, majority of that is actually leased to ranchers. So again, private landowners controlling them and managing of that land. And then the yellow areas are tribal lands, which represent about 5%, but are important partners with WWF because they're large areas, and we also have very, very similar conservation goals. So looking forward and looking at this reality was we realized we really need to be working with the ranching community. And you know, I think historically the ranching community and conservation haven't always seen eye to eye. But in fact, actually, as we look at the Northern Great Plains and the fact that ranchers manage the majority of this land, they're natural partners. So we find that there's actually a lot of conservation benefits with ranching, and much of this land cannot be used for other purposes other than being grazed, and it evolved naturally being grazed. And so we find that there's many benefits of grassland quality and wildlife habitat, pollinator habitat. And so we started about 5 years ago with just listening sessions, listening to ranchers, understanding their challenges, how can we be collaborative, and what can WWF do to help support them. And so a big lesson learned in all of this was it's about communities, it's about people, it's about families and a culture, and we have to be respectful and conscious of that. So we'll quickly kind of move towards the end here and wrap up, because I think I'm running short on time. I speak quickly about field to market. I've spoke a bit about our work with the ranching community and being an important part, but we've also are working with farmers in row crop agriculture through the field to market initiative, which brings together brands and traders, grower groups, government agencies, conservation organizations, and farmers themselves to develop indicators around eight key indicators to benchmark and track continuous improvement. You know, the issues facing U.S. agriculture from a conservation and environmental perspective are massive, but they're not, you can't lay them at the feet of any one individual farmer. You need change at scale. And so this is an initiative that is piloting programs and using what is called a field print calculator, where you can track your performance against these indicators. There's an economic component to help influence decisions and management, and building out a supply chain component so you can verify sustainability claims against this. And there's about, now there's about 200,000 acres in the program, and with goals to increase that to 1 million acres by the end of next year. And key partners in this are Cargill, ADM, and some of the grower groups like the Corn Growers Association, Wheat Growers, and United Soybean Association. So to wrap up, some of the challenges, again, that we think about: corruption and poor governance are systemic issues globally, and how we work with the private sector to put pressure on governments around the world to enforce laws. And as we think about increasing populations and consumption, do we have a Western-facing strategy on an Eastern-facing problem? We've spent most of our time focused on the Western consumer, Western multinational companies, but most of the population growth and consumption is going to be happening in Asia. And what's the strategy for influencing the Asian consumer around sustainability? Again, change is happening at a rate that's unprecedented. Can we adapt in time? And what are the roles of the trader in the 21st century? They're the link between the farmers and the brands and companies, but what is their role in finding solutions to sustainability issues that we think about? So again, we have an unprecedented period of uncertainty, but change and actions are needed now, and I think it's something that we think is we need proactive solutions and collaboration, and I thank everyone for your time today and allowing me to be here to chat. And I turn things over to Brian now. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's terrific to be here. My grandparents spent the last half of their years, I'm from Missouri, spent the last half of their life south of here down in Hot Springs. And in my intro, it was mentioned that I've done a number of marathons, and a number of them were what are called ultra marathons, 50 milers and 100 milers, you know, where you go out and you run ultra far, ultra slow. It's the world's worst spectator sport, by the way. But my grandmother, from down in Hot Springs, used to send me notes occasionally saying, well, I'm following your races all around the country, but why haven't you raced here? You know we have races here. We have long races here. We have marathons, 50 milers, and 100 milers up and down the Mickelson Trail. So finally, I submitted to be, I called her to give her the good news that I was coming to run, and she said, well, which race are you doing, Brian? And I said, well, I'm going to do the 50 miler. And she said, Brian, isn't there a 100 miler? And I said, yes, ma'am, there is. And she said, now, why wouldn't you do that? Like I was going to disgrace the family name or something, you know, in Hot Springs. If I didn't run the 100, and I'd run some before, but I muddled through in 22 hours, and it was a lovely place of the world, and it's the worst way in the world to see it, but it's a good way to do it. First, my compliments, to the organizers here and the kind welcome and the elected officials who are present here. When I used to work in the Senate, I was always a big fan of Senator Thune. My wife was always a fan of Senator Thune. I used to catch her watching him on C-SPAN, and the volume was on mute. Secretary Lynch and the director here from Nebraska, who's going to speak a little later, you know, they're unusual in that they're outspoken advocates for you. They're not just impartial bureaucrats. There are people who have come to the office not to be something, but to do something. And that's really, at the end of the day, the difference between, I think, good public servants and others in the elected field. I saw a piece of news that I think I should just share it before I forget about it. Susan Mushat Jones, has anyone heard of her? She's one of two people left in the world who were born in the 19th century. She was born in the 1800s, and she just turned 116. She lives in Alabama. McKinley was president when she was born. She said she owes her long life to eating bacon and eggs every morning for breakfast. So good on her, right? I work for Protect the Harvest. We're about food security and confronting the threats against it. We wade into politics. We are on state ballots. We do public education. We go to concerts, state fairs, events, car races all around the country. We work on legislation. We get involved in legal activities. And Tuesday night, lo and behold, and you'll perhaps see this in theaters come this fall, we've got a movie premiering in Los Angeles Tuesday night. I work for a guy, the guy who started it, his name's Forrest Lucas of Lucas Oil, Lucas Oil Stadium, Lucas Oil Products. People have heard of that. Mr. Lucas from southern Indiana. He grew up on a farm, not with a dirt floor, but he said they didn't have indoor plumbing. And then he drove a truck until he was in his late 40s, and he was poor. And then he started a lubricants company, and now he's not poor anymore. But he has an observation which moves him, which is simply that successful civilizations around the world are not so unless they rest on a foundation of food security. And he sees the goodness of the food security we have, and he sees the threats against it and how it's taken for granted here in the United States. I remember years ago when my father and my greatest mentor, long before some of these movements came along that told us how we were supposed to treat our animals responsibly. Dad always used one word, it was stress. And he said, you know, we're not in this business to make a million because we can't make a million. We're in it because we love our animals. But we also need to get the bills paid. And you guys all need to understand, he's talking to the cowboys, animals that are injured or sick or not properly fed or that are anxious, they don't gain as well, they don't breed as well, they don't milk as well, they're hard on employees, they're hard on fence. And in a word, I don't want stress. And that's the way it's been his whole life. And if you know much about him, you'd know you better have listened to him. We had a guy who worked for us once. Sorry, this one story reminds me of another. But he came in and he said, Glenn, I need to talk to you. He was a new guy, and he wasn't particularly impressive to date. And he came in and he said, I need to talk to you. Yes, I don't have much time. What do you need? He said, I don't think I'm being paid what I'm worth. Dad says, you ought to be glad. But today I have three observations, which are simply, in my view, ag has never been better. Number two, ag has never been more maligned. And number three, as Alex spoke very well of in a comprehensive way, the challenges to ag over the years ahead have never been greater. In my grandmother's lifetime, corn productivity provided seven times greater yields. We 100 million acres when she was born, still 100 million acres. About the time she was born, it took 5 acres to feed a person. Now it takes about a quarter acre to feed a person. In my lifetime, half the dairy cows produced twice the milk, and they use about 40% of the feed to produce a unit of milk. Pork uses, in my lifetime, about 40% of the water with a third less carbon footprint to produce a pound of pork. Genetically engineered BT cotton uses about half the pesticide that it used to rely upon. Half the soybeans now in the country are no-till. I was at a museum in Iowa not long ago, and they had an exhibit where they said when the Pilgrims settled the country, it took 22 hours to produce a bushel of corn, and it now takes 4 minutes. And I think the good news, and this is really the intersection, or part of the intersection between Alex and I, and you know, my observation of agriculture is that farmers are almost obsessed with sustainability. By any reasonable definition of sustainability, and it's got to start with economic sustainability. The economic sustainability of livestock keeps grassland grazed and unplowed, for example. But beyond that, you just never, you know, in all my years knowing farmers, and it's not just because they're good stewards of the land and they care about it, but because they're some of the tightest people you're ever going to meet, don't wake up in the morning and say, what I would like to do today is figure out how to write Bayer Crop Science a bigger check. If they have a product that is more sustainable, they're going to want to use it. But they're not going to want to use more pesticides, more herbicides, more fertilizer, more land, more feed inputs. They want to minimize inputs, and they want to maximize output. It is what they dedicate, what you dedicate your lives to every single day. I marvel sometimes, just again on another side note, there'll be several before I'm quite done, but I was with a scientist from Tuskegee recently, and he was originally born in India, and he's a molecular biochemist, and he is very interested in world hunger issues and technology, genetic engineering in particular. But he said some people's definition of sustainability is that we farm without synthetic or technological inputs. He said by that definition, he said I can tell you they've been sustainably farming in Africa for thousands of years, and the only thing it's sustained is misery, poverty, and hunger. So technology matters. Most of the good of modern agriculture, I would submit, is enjoyed not by producers as much as by consumers. There are roughly 40,000 supermarkets in the United States of America, and that's just a piece of the action. In those 40,000 supermarkets, there are roughly 40,000 choices. You have the lowest cost food options of any place in the world. It's abundant. You know it's going to be safe, and they have food options for the people who are concerned about safe, affordable products. And then you have options for the digestive elite who want to go to the egg counter and they want to get the organic, free-range, omega-3, three times the price option. I'm delighted it's there. There are terrific options, and outside of the supermarkets, there are plenty of options as well. Yet remarkably, in a place that where we should all be celebrating, you know, the success of the production, and the success that the consumer can have all these terrific options. There are voices that have maligned agriculture like never before. We often refer to them as first world problems. A lot of what it's about, unfortunately, is just simply about control. From a consumer standpoint, if someone wants a particular or a group want a particular kind of food, the consumers demand it. My strong hunch is it won't be very long before producers and retailers provide it. But in this case, we're not talking about providing me what I want to eat. We're talking about me trying to impose or dictate choices upon my choices upon you. It's about controlling how farmers produce, and it's about controlling the refrigerator and what people buy and what people eat. You've got groups, and you know, most of them are on the coasts. They're, you know, industrial-sized fundraising operations. They raise a lot of money. They're very influential. They're great with the media. You know, they're big pressure groups. Their business, unfortunately, in some cases, and I'm talking about the extreme ones, their business is putting you out of business. To be clear, they don't object to how you do what you do if you're in the livestock business, and I'm talking about the animal rights crowd. They don't object to how you do what you do. They object to what you do. One case in point where the impacts are very, I think, very meaningful, and we're perhaps looking into our future, and it's something we haven't paid attention to that I suspect and strongly suggest we better, is how California is now managing egg production. They put something on the ballot back in 2008, you may or may not know, which essentially said that an egg-laying hen needs this much space. And it passed by a significant margin. It passed, it's interesting looking at election results, because there's an election result going on about every second, every day at grocery stores, by the way. And in the state of California at the time of this, shoppers were buying the cheapest conventional eggs at rates right around 95%. And that's why, by the way, this was put on the ballot, is because shoppers weren't behaving the way they were supposed to be behaving. They went in and they bought the wrong eggs. They were supposed to be buying these expensive eggs, and instead they bought the affordable eggs. And the activist groups didn't like that, so they put this on the ballot, and you word it in such a way that it sounds like you don't like or care about chickens if you vote the wrong way. It passes by with a very small majority of the people voting. And then the aftermath comes later. Well, we'll get to the aftermath here in a second, but the immediate thing that happened right after is that the politicians there in California and the California egg producers realized that they could not compete with South Dakota and Missouri and Indiana and Iowa egg producers. So they did what California typically does to be competitive. They went about the process of making the rest of the country equally as uncompetitive. So what they did is they passed a law saying every egg sold in California also has to come from a hen and either turned out or in a cage this big. So they passed that. It's the subject of federal litigation, anti-constitutional barriers to trade, and probably in conflict with the Interstate Commerce Clause, the United States Constitution. But we'll see where that goes. But in the meantime, that went into effect January 1st, right? And what happened? The New York Times and the LA Times said it was going to be a good deal because it had, among other things, benefits for chickens, which, by the way, Michigan State University is coming out now saying turning these chickens out has about twice the mortality rate. That's a separate issue, but the issue I'm going to focus on is what it cost. And what it cost was not what the LA Times and the New York Times said it would cost, which was a penny an egg. That would be a dozen cents for a dozen, right? The price there skyrocketed. The prices there have doubled and in some case tripled. It wasn't widely reported what happened, and I decided to go out there for myself, and I did my own research. Since the Los Angeles Times apparently was not going to go outside the doors of their office and go to places in Los Angeles County where the poorest people in California live, I went out there and I spent 2 days. And I went to 24 little groceries. I went to places in East LA and Hyde and Huntington and Vernon and Watts, places, let's just say, where I stuck out. And I walked into these, Beverly Hills can handle the price hikes. I understand that, and that's fine. I can stand the price hikes. But a quarter of the population in California is in poverty. So I went to these places just to see whether it was a penny an egg. It wasn't. From the Midwestern retail prices, the prices there had doubled at best. And in most cases, they had tripled. So essentially what we had is a food tax on the poor, which one would think is newsworthy, particularly since this is our country's cheapest animal protein. At least it used to be. Now matters have been made worse, as the Secretary said this morning with the bird flu. It was interesting at one point during, as this unrolled in California, one of the Farm Bureau presidents called me and said that NPR wants to talk to me about what's going to happen to egg prices because they don't believe there's going to be significant price inflation. And I said, well, NPR should read their own news coverage because they covered the same story in Europe in 2012 when they unrolled their big cage regulations. And there, NPR reported that, quote, in some regions, prices have skyrocketed 250%. And the headline was, egg shortage in European Union. I did a napkin analysis last night after Alex and I were talking as well, and this kind of gets to some of the sustainability and where some of these folks want us to go. The European Union has a definition. I'm not sure. 2 minutes? Okay. They have a definition of free-range chicken compliance that says that the stocking density should be about 400 chickens per acre. We have 8 billion chickens in the United States. I just wondered if we took all this to the logical extreme and went as far as some of these folks actually wanted us to go, and we turned loose 8 billion chickens onto this EU stocking density, it would require 20 million American acres, which is almost the size of Indiana, which is probably not what Alex has in mind. So we'll look forward to working together against some of these extreme animal rights agenda items in the future. Well, I just have a couple of minutes left, so let me jump forward just to talk a little bit more about, the threats are from the activist groups, the threats are more and more from what we call corporate regulators. Nestle Foods, for example, of all people, they're a $100 billion food company, the largest in the world. They claim that they want to be socially responsible. and they stand up and they embrace a lot of this extreme animal welfare, animal rights agenda, which all drives up the price for the poor, which we're having a hard time reconciling how, on the one hand, you can make billions of dollars selling junk food, selling obesity, selling diabetes to the public, and claim to be socially responsible by also increasing the price of food and reducing the food choices to the poor. The 50 million people on food stamps in America are also Nestle consumers. It's not just the well-to-do. But you've got Panera and you've got Chipotle and you've got the organics the solutions apparently are to go vegan, to go natural, to go local, to go organic, gluten-free, GMO-free. I saw a poll some years ago that French citizens, by 70%, want the DNA out of their food. But meanwhile, and I'll close with this before I get another finger, the wrong one this time, right? In this whole food debate, please observe, low-income people are not at the table. We have a big job ahead of us, as Alex mentioned. We're going to have 9 billion people coming to the food, coming to dinner. And we're supposed to double, if not more, the world's food supply. It is going to take technology to do it. It's going to take modern practices to do it. We're not going to be able to farm like we did in 1950, whether we liked it then or not, when even America had 180 fewer people to feed. We do have to figure out ways, working with groups like Alex, that is one of the cooperative groups, that is one of the constructive groups, in my strong opinion, to try to figure out better ways to do what we do, to use technology, to use modern practices, to be wiser, to make things work and fit where they fit, to produce the extra food that's necessary while also using less energy with a smaller carbon footprint and less water and less land. I know I've often said the villain by those who are maligning agriculture is often the solution, which is technology. And for goodness sakes, technology is not the enemy, hunger is the enemy. I mean, even today we have 880 million people in chronic, suffering from chronic malnutrition. 2.5 billion people in the world eat on less than $2 a day. And we're talking about removing tools necessary so that they can enjoy the next day of life, the things that we take for granted. I was with Norman Borlaug once, and he said, quote that I'll never forget, he said, you know, a well-fed person has a great many problems. He says, a hungry person, they just have one. And that, to a big part of the world, and even a big part of America as we look into the future, is going to be a big issue. I'm confident that the enterprising, dynamic agricultural sector, working with the technological sector, if they're not encumbered with the overly encumbered with the ball and chain of the activist sector, can get where we need to go. But we are all going to have to use our collective minds and our collective voices. Farmers are great at growing things. They're great at taking care of the land. They're great at taking care of animals. To date, I think we're piss poor at self-promotion. We're lousy at talking to people. But transparency is our friend, particularly the young people who know how to do this stuff. We've got a great story to tell. The more people know about who you are and what you do, what trajectory you're on, where you've been, where you've improved to, where you're going to improve tomorrow, the better relationship we'll have with our urban partners, and we'll have success at perhaps the greatest challenge of the next century. Thank you.
Thank you. thank you to both of our speakers for both of those presentations. I know I certainly learned a lot. We do have a good amount of time set aside during the panel for questions from the audience. There is a microphone right down here in the middle. Please, if you have a question, don't be shy. Come forward and ask. We'd love to have some audience participation. So while you're thinking of a question, I do have one. Both of you kind of hinted at this. You know, we have, Alex, I believe you said some studies have shown that we'll have to produce in the next 30 to 40 years as much food as we have in the last 8,000 years. So we have a significant challenge ahead of us in terms of producing food. And yet, Brian, you talked about the impact that consumers and their personal beliefs and their actions have on technology that we use to produce that additional food. So from each of your perspectives, where do we find a solution to that sort of problem? Is it our role in agriculture to educate consumers more, or do we listen to consumers more and do what they're asking us to do, even though it may not make the most economic sense or be the best for producing more food?
The answer is both, I think. You know, you're not going to get around consumer sentiment. Consumers always right, even when you as a producer may know that they're wrong. But education's got to be a big piece of this, and we have got to drift back. And this starts with elected people, and particularly the big news media across the country, have got to get back to where science matters. They're still searching in the world for the first GMO-created stomachache, right? Yet you've got people out there saying it kills people, and almost everything does. By the way, there, you know, I don't know of anything that isn't. The standard of perfection is a ridiculous standard. Oddly, when it comes to human health, by all evidence, GMOs are meeting it, which I don't expect them to do. I don't expect anything to do. But we've got to get back to the science. You know, when there is such universal agreement, not just in the United States, not just with our government, not just with the Academy of Science and doctors and Academy of Sciences around the world and other governments, we've got, when they say that GMOs are safe, that ought to mean something to the American public. The media once reported that. They don't now. I'm not sure why. When I say media, I'm talking about the big media. But we're going to have to do a lot of both, because the challenges are too great for us to take the greatest tool we have, technology and innovation, out of the game.
Either one. Yep, we have the table mics there if you'd like to use those. There's a button on the bottom.
I would echo Brian's sentiments. I think that we need to be directed by science and look to science to guide the way. I also think communication is going to be a big part of this. And part of communication and credible communication is, from our perspective, comes through multi-stakeholder efforts, where you've got all groups together sending the same message. And so I think, you know, being guided by science, the challenges are great, so we need all options on the table. It isn't just one silver bullet solution. All options should be viable, and all systems of production should be on the table, and all systems can continue to improve. So,
did we have anyone in the audience that has a question? Yeah, right down here.
I'm Jan Brockle from Selby. Brian, I wonder if you could tell us a little bit more about the Protect the Harvest program you mentioned.
Did you say the program? I'm sorry. Okay. We started in 2005 when the Humane Society of the U.S., this is distinguished, by the way, from your local shelters and rescues, you know, who are your neighbors who take care of pets and do a good job. This is the folks who raise money using the notion of taking care of unwanted pets, and then they spend less than 0.5% on that function and use largely most of the rest of their programmatic money attacking agriculture. They came to Missouri with a hostile ballot initiative, and they brought $5 million with them. And the agricultural groups in Missouri didn't know how to handle it, and it's because, you know, as I said before, they're good at producing, and they're good at caring, but they're not very good at politicking, and they're not very good at public relations and self-promotion. By the way, they used to call that humility, and it used to be a virtue, but in the modern electronic age, that's with selfies, that's no longer a viable option, I'm afraid. We were getting killed 70 to 30 in the polls, and agriculture was fixing to lose. And 10 days out, someone went to Mr. Forrest Lucas, who has some cattle in Missouri, he calls it his golf game. And they said, someone went to him and said, "Will you put up some yard signs?" And he said, "For what?" And they told him for what. And he said, I won't quote him directly, but he said, "You're not going to beat HSUS with blanking yard signs." And he went on the air with $400,000 explaining what this was going to do to ordinary Missourians. And it did pass in the end, unfortunately. It just passed by a sliver. It moved from 70 points down to 51 points. And then the legislature undid it. So he started Protect the Harvest basically to carry out these kind of fights, to do political messaging, to provide private legal support where it was necessary, not just we're on a third state now, and Oklahoma is will be working next year to pass before the voters question number 777 to provide a constitutional amendment guaranteeing a farming rights amendment access to a technology that's safe and modern practices, unless there is a very compelling public interest to the contrary. So we go out and about and try to stand up for productive agriculture.
Thank you. We have another question.
Good morning. My name is Bethany Rose. This question is for Brian specifically. You talked a lot about GMOs and how scientifically they've been proven that they are healthy. But I've noticed even in South Dakota, and I know across the country, it's really become a marketing ploy to push that something is non-GMO. Strawberries in a grocery store will have something that says non-GMO variety. That's every strawberry that's sold. How maybe is your organization, and then how can we as people within production really work to make sure that we're not being victimized for doing something that's scientifically safe?
Yeah, yeah, it's really hard when a corporate retailer does it. And, you know, some of this is frustrating. We were talking yesterday about how, you know, you've got these companies are out there that are simply disparaging their competitors so they can win more market share for themselves. It is pure profit motive. They may or may not believe it. I've heard some interesting stories about the CEO, the founder of a Whole Foods. He just says, "Look, I don't even buy into the concept, but it's a hell of a good business." You know, and I understand that. And you want to distinguish your product, but you know, you don't see a Ford television commercials saying, "Buy a Ford truck, General Motors will kill you." But you see that in you see that in food. And really, I think eventually when you stray away from the science, ultimately these people in the food business are essentially calling an airstrike in on their own position. And it's not going to be there yet. But what can we do? It's really hard. You know, what do you do to corporations that just decide they want to willy-nilly go do it, Cheerios, General Mills, GMO-free. Well, I don't buy Cheerios anymore, but I'm just one somebody. One of the things that we've done is we've gone out to some of these hunger groups, and we've started to brief them on what's going on to try to partner with them. And, I can explain it in more courteous words, but we have drafted some hate mail for them to consider sending to some of these companies saying, you know, "Hey, it's great that you're taking care of the well-to-do, but what about us?" Right? And perhaps, you know, if they care about some of these activist groups, I suspect they might also be willing to care about advocates for the needy in America. So, you know, that's, but you can't make them do it. It's out there in the free market, right? So.
Do we have additional questions? We'll see how fast the secretary can move over there.
He's a good staffer.
Yes, he is.
Eleanor Jones, South Dakota State University. One of the things that you bring up address in a global context, the issues of culture and social mores and norms, as well as the politics that are involved with this. As we look at this in a global context, one of the problems that we've had that came to light really in the mid-90s with GMOs was this different interpretation of the different legal constructs. So in this country, our legal structure protects the corporation first. In Europe, it prioritizes the consumer. So under the precautionary principle, we have this disconnect in how our legal structures can be interpreted in this environment. Can you comment on how these types of disconnects are really going to be a problem as we move in and increasingly into this global environment? And as we have countries involved in trade that really don't have a rule of law, let alone the potential misinterpretations and miscommunications as we move forward.
Yeah, and I agree there are disconnects, and I agree that there are countries that have no constructs. I strongly disagree that the United States doesn't look after the consumer first. That's not the way the federal law works, first of all. And we used to have maybe perhaps some of your neighbors, if your accent betrays you, come into our U.S. Senate office and say, well, we realize that you and Senator Kip Bond's office from Missouri have to be from Monsanto because they're a big company in Missouri. And I explained to them the asinine notion that we would be willing to put at risk 6 million, the political notion that we'd be willing to put at risk 6 million of our constituents for 5,000 corporate employees who are among the 6 million at risk. You know, by the way, and I'm going to stray just one thing. I've been fortunate to go through DuPont and Monsanto. I'm going to do the unthinkable and say something nice about Monsanto and DuPont. And I'm not talking about, you know, where their CEO offices are, but if you've ever been, I encourage you to go to their research facilities. Because politically speaking, it's the strangest thing. You're going to walk in, and there are lots of people there. You're going to find that almost half of them appear to be women, almost half of them appear to be foreign. And if you get to know them to some degree, you know what you're going to find, politically speaking? A bunch of liberal do-gooders who want to use the power of technology to solve world problems. Yet they're disparaged by so many of their colleagues. And they would be the first people, they'd be the very first people who would go screaming to the federal government, to law enforcement, to the media, if they found out that what they were working on was going to be injurious to their kids and the kids of their neighbors. I just find it the strangest thing, you know, that the technology, particularly in Europe, is disparaged in the way it is. And I think, you know, the Europeans have succeeded in starving the Africans countries of technology. And books have been written about it, and it's very sad. But the disconnect, back to your question, it is a permanent process. So, yes.
To add just a little bit on Brian's points, but I would say the disconnect from the conservation community is, you know, what's the problem we're trying to solve? You know, is it about GM versus non-GM, or are we trying to protect forests or habitat? And I think that's, you know, we've tried to be focused on impacts of production and management. And so if we can focus on those things, that's, you know, from our perspective, where our focus needs to be. That's all I'd like to add.
I think we probably have time for one or two more questions. Looks like we have one over here.
Thank you. Big companies are fine, science and technology, we need it. But on the common sense side of things, I was wondering about what you guys thought about the food hub movement, the idea of food hubs, in other words, growing our food locally, edible food crops that we can grow, putting it back into the local area, or regional area. It makes so much sense. It eliminates a lot of packaging, transportation, and so forth. So growing edible food crops ourselves where we can seems to be part of a solution, maybe.
Yeah, this time I can be short and just agree. I'm not, with the challenges ahead, I'm not sure any good option should be taken off the table. We spent a lot of time in Vermont, the director and the secretary, we were there with the National Association of State Directors of Agriculture, and they had, you know, very robust efforts in that regard. And this relationship between the producer and the consumer worldwide can only be strengthened by having various options. Now, as someone pointed out in Vermont, Vermont is very advanced in that regard, but they still import 85% of the food that they eat from out of state. But it is very good, particularly for farmers and for consumers who want that kind of specialty option.
Yes, and I would say absolutely all options are should be on the table, and the local food movement is a good one. I think, you know, the secretary made a comment of, you know, there's less and less people in agriculture and in rural communities today, and more people are living in cities. So I think anything that connects people to how food is produced, connects them closer to agriculture, is a good thing. But it's not about, you know, local food versus commercial food. It's about just different options, and so anything that helps with building knowledge and awareness and education is a good thing.
Okay, well, I hope that we got around to most of you and your questions. We are nearing the time for our break, and so I want to thank our two panelists on the session one this morning. Thank you for being here and for the knowledge that you've shared with us. So at this time, we're going to recess for a morning break. This will be a good opportunity for networking for all of you, as well as just stretching your legs and perhaps checking out of your hotel room if you need to do that. I noticed a little sign that said that checkout time is 11, so this will be the last break before that. Enjoy the refreshments that are located in the hallway, and we will reconvene here promptly at 10:30 a.m. Enjoy.